for the curse. There's no real rules. The whole idea is just to have a conversation.
Don't encourage me to curse. It's already bad enough.
Are you really good at it? Is it?
It's just, you know, it's one of these things where I hate when I see directors do it. Like, can I take a phone call?
You can take phone calls, yeah. Well, no. Depends who the call is.
Shane, tell Warren that I'll call him back, please.
No,
thank
problem.
You. Okay.
Are you recutting Warren's movie?
Yeah, that was, you know, when I first started working with Bob, it seemed like every time the phone would ring, it would be some massive icon. You know, it'd be like, Mr. Evans, Warren Beatty's on the tell Warren, and I'm talking to Brett Morgen right now. I can't be bothered. Yeah, that I finally figured out that it may be.
So every phone, he has an icon phone and a regular phone.
It was just
only icons call on the one line.
Yeah, exactly.
He's prepared. So you are not you are a veteran, to say the least.
Yeah.
At this point, it's been, what, 15 years longer?
16 years since On the Ropes.
Yeah. Good Lord. Does it feel like a lifetime ago?
There's been a lot of, yeah, it does actually. You know, it feels like this is a really amazing moment and period that I didn't think I was ever going to arrive at again. Like, you know, and I'm really appreciating everything now much more than the first time around. In fact, I was writing with Nanette Burstein the other day. I never speak to her, not for any reason other than we have different lives. And I don't think we've change emails more than like once in the last 10 or 12 years. And we were talking about how when you're, you know, when your first movie gets nominated for an Oscar and wins the Directors Guild Award, wins the IDA Award, I mean, I hate to say it, but it seems so easy. You know, and it's hard not to take it for granted. You know, I have this vivid memory of being at the Academy Awards and we lost to One Day in September. And as they're going up to get the thing, I was like, don't worry, this back next year. It's so, yeah. And so, you know, and you put the same energy and passion to everything. You know, it doesn't matter. Like, and sometimes it works and sometimes it doesn't. You know, and it's not, I'm the same person. I approach the work the same way, but sometimes they connect with people and sometimes they don't. And this Cobain film has connected with people in a way that's just floored me. And I had this experience this weekend, which was, I think, the highlight of my career, really, at this point, which was I was at the Dome, and we were the first documentary to sell out the Dome, and we did it Friday and Saturday night at 8 o'clock. And I'm really OCD. I never enjoy watching my movies because it's either the sound's too low or it's too hot or the picture's not right or someone's getting up to go to the bathroom. And there's always something to distract you. And I had, on Saturday, the perfect moment where the film never sounded better. It's never looked better. 800 people in my hometown, nobody got up to go to the bathroom. And I was consciously, I mean, I started crying thinking that this is everything that spent all the 8 years and really a whole career building towards. And to have that, it's like pitching a perfect game just in that one moment. You know, just in that singular moment, it was the first time where I just felt satisfied, you know, artistically and creatively, and it was, a lot of it was the Dome, which is, I don't ever want to screen anywhere else at this point. I mean, it's like I'm trying to promote the movie, but I keep tweeting just about the Dome, like go see it in the Dome, because it's such a amazing place to exhibit a film like this, which is so immersive.
Well, you grew up out here?
I grew up in Studio City. And so, yeah, so we, that, you know, that was the theater we used to, for big, you know,
right, that was the place.
Or like, you know, big event films, we'd go over there. And it's really just to get there with a documentary. And I went to Evan's house last night. And it's interesting how life works. You know, I was on a plane, I've been on this junket for 3 months nonstop. And I haven't been home in 6 weeks, and I was flying back from the New York premiere to go to the LA premiere, and the Kid Sees in the Picture came up on my playlist on iTunes, and I'm listening to What'll I Do? I got really emotional. And so yesterday I was driving to do a Q&A on a Monday night at the at the ArcLight, and I'm driving down Sunset, and I was passing the Beverly Hills Hotel, and I called Bob's house, and I said, "Do you mind if I come over? I haven't seen him in years, or in a year or something." And it's just interesting that I was just drawn. I just wanted to be with him in that moment. You know, and I said to him, because Bob used to say, everyone always says, since On the Ropes of the Kid, when are you going to make movies? When are you going to make, you know, fiction films? When are you going to do fiction films? And, you know, I said to Bob, I go, you know, there's all these people, and they're almost setting you up to be a failure. You know, it's like, when are you going to do, like, as if these aren't. And I said, you know, I got to tell you that one of the things that made me so proud this weekend, you know, we did $73,000 at the ArcLight with no advertising. I mean, it's unheard of, you know? And I said, one of the things that made me so proud in that moment was that we did it with a documentary, and an uncompromised documentary. And that, to me, was so gratifying, you know, rather than, like, you know, doing a, you know, and I want to make fiction one day, but I, you know, I don't know. I've had such an amazing run on this movie that I don't know what, like, if I did a fiction film, how does it get better? I don't understand. I don't know. But anyway.
So do you think that this attachment, which, you know, the current child is always the most beloved, but it sounds like it's more than that in this case. Is it because of the process? Is it because of the material? Is it because you are just come to a point in your life? Or
this is, you know, this movie was, people ask me a lot if it was difficult to, if I took the work home with me, because the subject matter is really difficult. And I never found that at all. I found it to be so inspiring to work on this film. Like, really creatively challenging in the best way imaginable, you know, that kept me up all night thinking about it. And it wasn't until the film was finished that it got emotional. And we went, this was a movie where at the very start I told the team, and I had a young team with me on this, and I said, listen, at the end of production, everybody does all-nighters, so we're going to go different. We're going to do that at the beginning of the film so we can coast home at the end. But that never happened. You know? Right. So we were going full throttle the whole time. This is a terrible idea. I'll never do it again. And but the last 106 days, we didn't have a day off. Like, literally, legitimately, no day off.
Getting it ready for Sundance
for me. Yeah. And then you go to Sundance with no sleep, totally sleep deprived, and there's these microphones thrown in your face because it's Kurt and everyone wants to talk about it. And that's where I started to break down, because it's very emotional talking about Kurt, and I hadn't had time to process the experience yet of making the film, and so I was just a mess. And it's only and I think it was Saturday night was the first time I felt like I can start to walk away, like it was done. Like I finally, that's why that was such an important moment, that after going on this whole journey and doing countless interviews and everything else, that it finally felt right.
Had you ever met Kurt?
I'd seen him play twice, and, you know, I never met him in life, but I feel like I got to know him better than I know just about any one of my friends. Because, you see, I got to meet Kurt through primary sources, and there were a lot of primary sources. And I mean, he documented his life like no one else I've ever experienced, because he documented through art and through his expression, and which is why we talk about Kurt, because he was something so primal about the way he was able to express his feelings. And from the time he can hold a paintbrush, he was creating. And so in a way, he left this oral and visual autobiography of his life. And what's so unique about it is that, unlike some artists, like, I'm a filmmaker and that's all I do. I don't do anything else. But I know people who, like, you know, they play guitar and they make films, or they paint and they act, or whatever it is. I've never experienced another human being in my life who works across as many different mediums as Kurt. So we did, you know, the audio collage that were amazing, which are the sound design for the film. You know, he did score, which, and the Nirvana music, and spoken word. He's narrating this film, but it's not just, you know, the story in the film when he loses his virginity. He's performing it. It's not like he's telling a journalist this story. He's actually, it's a tape that he's performing. So there was all this amazing oral stuff, and then visually, he has all these paintings and still photographs and Super 8 films. And so if you think about film as 50% sound and 50% image, Here you have an artist who has worked across all mediums to provide the ultimate immersive experience of his life. And that was the other thing that's so difficult with this is, like, given the type of films I make, he was the ultimate subject. And even if he was, you know, John Smith from, you know, Cambridge, Massachusetts, I think the film would have been fascinating to see the story of a boy on his journey through life depicted not from the outside, but from the inside out. And it, you know, there was very little reference point making it. And then I saw Boyhood last summer. And John Slusta, I think, was offended in the way that I said this. But I said, because John hadn't seen my movie, I called him up. I said, you know, I saw your movie. I got to tell you, it's as close as I feel I've experienced to what we're trying to do with this. Because in many ways with Kurt, you literally, it's cradle to the grave. Mm-hmm. You're seeing him as a six-month-old, and you go through this journey of life. And of course, the first section, you know, it was Kurt's life was so heavily documented. Did you ask me a question?
I did, but you're doing good. No, you're great. You're doing great.
Terrible Molly. Go ahead, David. Yeah. Well, what I was going to say is that Kurt's childhood is such a cornerstone of the mythology, both the one that he created and every biography of Kurt. And it's almost amazing when you think about that his entire childhood was documented, not just documented, but shot in pristine Super 8 that looks like, you know, something William Eglison would have created, you know, with these vivid colors. And it's really revealing in terms of what is happening. And his mother and father and sister have never spoken on camera. So you have all these people trying to figure out Kurt. And it's almost mind-blowing that the thing that you can go to try to access it, the footage, and the mother and father and sister, the only people who could testify, have never been a part of any of these other biographies or movies. And it just everything kind of came together for this. And that was Frances, you know, everyone wanted to participate for her.
Well, somebody needs to tell the story. I mean, that's in some ways it's like if anything seems true of Kurt from this outside perspective, it's that he did all this without planning it to be a biography. You know, was not building towards a goal, that it was just the work within, you know, at the moment, at whatever time in his life, he was just doing it. And that ultimately somebody had to come along to, you know, rope it all in to make this happen. What was the first idea? What was the first moment that this was
came to be
a light in your eyes? Yeah.
Well, Courtney got a hold of me in 2007, and she was, and I went in to meet with her. You know, I was a little apprehensive. She was, speaking of Bennett, she was really close with Bennett. And so I called him, and he was like, oh, no, she's great. Yeah, whatever. So I went and met with her at the Beverly Hills Hotel, and she said, you know, everybody knows Kurt from Nirvana, but I have all this art. And I think, you know, and she said, she told me this story that she was just coming out of a pretty major druggy period of her life, where she lived in a loft in New York, and she had a TV, a tent, and a DVD player and two movies. It was The Kid Stays in the Picture and the Gina Gershon film.
Bound?
No, the rock and roll one. Living for Rock and Roll or something. Oh, Pray for Rock and Roll.
Yeah.
So she had those two movies, and she said she watched The Kid Stays in the Picture every day for 3 months. And she loved what we did with ephemera and photographs. And so thought it would be a right fit. What she had no idea of at that moment was how much my childhood and my life experiences paralleled Kurt's, and how personal this film would get for me. And nor did she know, have any idea how sort of stubborn I am and tenacious, and because it was, that started 6 years before we could actually start making the film. Where there was nobody saying, you know, I was the producer, it was just me trying to like navigate through all these rights. And
and that was all just starting just like a couple years after Kid?
Yeah, that was 2007. So it took years to sort of wrangle. When I met with Courtney, I assumed she had the rights, but she didn't. She had the limited rights. And so we had to go and collect, or I had to go and collect everything. And it was a blessing. Because in those intervening years, something happened. Francis came of age. Mm. And there was a point where Francis and Courtney, everything was on hold for 2 years while they were dealing with some legal issues. And out of that, Francis was given a larger voice in how the estate was going to be run. So I went to meet with her to pitch her the movie. Mm-hmm. And I walked into her house and she shook my hand and she said, "We just met, but I know you, I already know you more than I know my father." Hmm. And I wasn't prepared for that. And I know what she meant. Kurt, she was only 20 months old. She has no memory of Kurt. And I think in that moment, the whole film changed for me in a lot of ways, because I wasn't making a film for the fans and I wasn't making a film for me. I was making it for Francis. And there was an opportunity to bring a daughter closer to her father. And because Francis, I think, had sort of had this very complicated relationship with him, where she knew him, but it was at arm's length. We sat down in her breakfast nook, and before I could tell her what I wanted to make, she just sort of spitballed this all this stuff that she was saying, that everywhere she goes, people call, you know, think he's like Santa Claus. You know, "Your dad's so cool, your dad's so..." Well, really, because if you're Francis, that's pretty complicated. Mm-hmm. You know? And she said, "Whatever we do, make it real." And I was like, "Well, do you want to..." Because she was young, I think she was 20. And I said, "Do you want to, do you have any interest in film? Do you want to come hang out in the edit room? Do you want to go through the process? Because I'm more than happy, like, it's going to be like film school or whatever." Mm-hmm. And she was like, "No, I don't want anything to do with that. You're the filmmaker. You make the movie. You call me when you're ready to show me something. I got my own shit I'm doing. I don't, you know." And so I went to the storage facility. So her and Courtney gave me the keys to the storage facility. Actually, the first time I went with Francis. And that was beyond intense. Mm. She hadn't really, she'd been there once for like 2 minutes with a bunch of lawyers. And so it was just her and I and her fiance.
This is up in Seattle or?
No, this is in California. And, you know, we opened up the doors to the space and Kurt's stuff, his boxes are sort of laid out. And, you know, she started going through everything, you know, almost like it was Christmas morning. Mm. You know, and she has the same aesthetic as Kurt. Like, it's amazing. Like, who knows, H.R. Puffin stuff has passed down through your genes.
Genetics.
Yeah, I mean, it was amazing because that's my kitschy generational mm-hmm. stuff, but it's also Francis's. Because when I went to her house the first time, I was like amazed at, like, I was like, wow, this could be Kurt's house. Mm. And yet there was this distance. And as she's going through all this stuff, that's really where it was clear that there's no way emotionally she was ready to go through and evaluate everything in this facility. Mm-hmm. It would take months for her to do it on her own, and there was no way that was ever going to happen. So it was my responsibility to go through this facility, this storage facility, document everything for her, and so I can give her this film. And you know, you make films for all sorts of different reasons, and I've always made films. You know, I'm not a social documentarian. Mm. You know, even on The Ropes, I thought it was a piece of entertainment, and Chicago 10, I was drawn to more because I wanted to do like a Sam Peckinpah montage mm-hmm. movie rather than the politics of it all. But, so, you know, I'm always into it for entertainment's sake or whatever. This time, I'm a father of three. And that just informed everything. And at that point, I was like, this is the job we have to do. And the beauty of this whole situation is that, you know, when you do these authorized movies, it generally means watered down. Mm-hmm. But because of Frances's unique position, where she's Kurt's daughter, but doesn't have that same, I don't know what it is, experience, whatever. She's sort of, as she says, she feels like she was best to tell the story, because if it was the mother's point of view, it would be through rose-tinted glasses. And if mm-hmm. it was Chris and Dave's point of view, they would also maybe try to shape things. But Francis just said, "I just want the truth." And it's so admirable, you know, that she would, because that's not necessarily the most business savvy thing to do,
right?
You know, and it was a gift she gave me, you know, of Final Cut, and you know, to just blessing to go there.
So what's it like to go? What's it like to go through anybody's life in a series of boxes in a room full of items, many of which are very personal, much less Kurt Cobain?
Yeah, you know, it's interesting. I had spent the year prior to that in the Rolling Stones archives. Mm. And, you know, it's a little more organized. There's like, here's the music and here's the film and here's, you know, the costumes. And I mean, it's not digitized yet, which is amazing. But it's, you know, it's a little more put together. These were just boxes. So there was no map or guide as to what we were going to unearth. And
presumably the Stone stuff, that whatever they might have not wanted to be in there wasn't in there.
I guess. I mean, look, I saw every frame of Cocksucker Blues, so I don't know what else there could have been that would have been more, like, horrific than that. I mean, I remember my wife flew to London because I was like, this is a once-in-a-lifetime chance. We're going to screen through every frame of Cocksucker Blues on a flatbed. And she came to London, and I mean, literally, we would walk out of that place. Just, I mean, you talk about wanting a shower. Like, we needed an ocean every night. It was so, god damn, that was rough. Anyways, with Kurt, the thing was, there were these boxes, and it wasn't really that, there was no organization to it for the most part. And so everything was a revelation. And I didn't know that much about Kurt, you know? So I'm learning about him as I'm pulling this stuff out. And when you do archival films, each piece of archival that you unearth, in a way, is like a word. And every two pieces is a sentence. And every box is a page. Mm. And this is your script. This is what's going to dictate the narrative, you know, what you have to work with. And I remember being slightly underwhelmed by the amount of material. When I walked in and visually looked at it, mm-hmm. there were like 18 boxes, but they weren't big boxes. There were paintings around the wall, but there weren't hundreds of paintings around the wall. But in fact, these boxes, the first time I remember feeling like they felt really small in the space, and having that terrible sinking feeling, like, what did I just sign up for? But Courtney never mentioned there was going to be audio. Mm. And nobody mentioned there were going to be all these home movies, and they don't take up a lot of space. So I opened up this one box, and there's 107 cassettes in there. Mm. And most of them had never been heard. Like, and once again, here's Kurt Cobain, the most, you know, everybody's been trying to research him. And there's that story of him losing his virginity, mm-hmm. that he recorded in 88, threw in a box, and there it sat for 25 years. You know, it's like a remarkable, mind-blowing. I'm listening to Kurt do this cover of the Beatles, and I loved her. And then, you know, eventually find out from Chris and Tracy and Courtney, nobody had ever heard it. I mean, it was just amazing. And then you start to get this picture of this kid who's just doing this to entertain himself. Mm-hmm. And as I got deeper and deeper into the material, I think when I walked in there, I thought that the foundation would be all of this three-dimensional art, like these sculptures and these monkeys, and we were taking pictures from, you know, 57 different angles on each object because we thought we were going to have to do photo animation on them. Mm-hmm. But it turned out to be much simpler, or I don't know if simple is the right word, but it was the audio, because in the audio you can access Kurt when he's alone. And if you think about it, where else can you do that with a subject? Mm-hmm. You know, nobody can tell you what David's like when David's alone. Your mm-hmm. wife cannot tell us what David's like when David's alone. But Kurt recorded all the time. And I started to hear, like, you know, he would do these spoken word things where he'd crack himself up. And I'd never heard Kurt like that in any other form of media. Mm-hmm. And then when I came across that audio autobiography, which really is like the rosebud, you know, it was the moment where everything came together. You start to get this picture in your head. So here's this young man, he's 19, 20 years old, and he's writing a story out in a journal. And it's sort of an embellishment of a real life experience, most likely. And he's editing it, and then he goes across the room and grabs a microphone, and he records it. But he doesn't just record it; he performs it, and he performed it on multiple takes. And you know, you sort of go, well, what was he doing? Was he doing it for me? Did he think that I was going to come around? Like, was this some sort of prophetic thing? And then you realize that he did it because he had to do it. Mm. That he was compelled to do it. That was how he expressed himself. And it wasn't enough just to write it out. He wanted to take it to the next level. And that's why I'm so humbled by him as an artist. You know, he never stopped. It's like what Kim Cobain says at the beginning. And it was also a curse. But it's so interesting, given that he was the poster child for Gen X.
Yeah.
And he would come off very narcoleptic in his interviews. He would be, sometimes he'd fall asleep in an interview. Mm-hmm. And so he presented himself as this sort of lazy, laconic, lethargic guy. But then you see what he left behind. And for a guy who was, you know, between homes for a big part of his life and was constantly... moving around, how he saved all this stuff is just remarkable.